Because, you know, the layers of the Earth are sort of about granule size.
No, they're not.
Oh, my God. Evan, they're not. They're not sorted that way.
JR, the preponderance of strata on the Earth, regardless of what rock formation they're in, with the exception of outcrops of granite or basins, is sorted by granule size. And this has been you can examine this, and there are secular geology sources that will tell you so. Not creationists, but secular geologists will tell you so. And
then we have a layer of I've seen the layers of a sandstone between limestone, yeah. Between two layers of limestone. So yeah. I mean, are you saying that the limestone on top is of a finer grain than the limestone beneath the sand beneath the?
I would have to look. I'm sorry. I would have to look at that particular strata you're referring to. I couldn't really comment on any given one without examining it myself. I'm saying that the preponderance of strata on the Earth are sorted by granule size. And what Micah was discussing is hydrologists have demonstrated how the stratification of the Earth takes place, and it's done by rapidly moving water moving horizontally across the Earth. The flood would have created exactly this because it was water moving horizontally from the mid-oceanic ridge. And so if a global flood, a lot of evolutionists have this false idea that, you know, the Earth was like God holding a giant garden hose filling up the oceans, and it's like a giant bathtub until the Earth was covered with water, and then the water dissipated. That's not how the flood occurred at all. You know, it was a terribly violent event. The Earth split open at the oceanic ridges, and water rushed and roared across the continents, moving away from the mid-oceanic ridge and across all the continents of the Earth. And so what we would see from a situation like that, such an event as that, is exactly what we see in the strata of the Earth. Strata formed horizontally by rapidly moving water, sorted by granule size, predominantly sorted by granule size.
They're not sorted by granule size.
They certainly are, and no, I'd be happy
they're
to...
They're not in any particular layer.
I would show you... I would be happy to show you a photograph of strata that are sorted by granule size. You can examine, if you go into Google Images and just do strata and start looking at, zoom in real close on looking at these pictures of strata, you'll find exactly what I'm saying, that you'll find, if you keep looking, you'll see that a considerable percentage of the strata of the Earth are sorted by granule size.
If you looked at one particular strata over one period of time up close, then it would make sense that was deposited by granule size if it was a fairly quick and brief period of deposition.
Well, we find that throughout the geologic column, though, all the way, you know, from the bottom to top, as far as we've dug, that strata are typically sorted by granule size.
No, the individual stratas are in no particular order. We have limestone on top of shale stone, and chalk on top of sandstone.
Again, I say that the preponderance of strata of the Earth are sorted by granule size. And you can find secular geologists which discuss this sorting by granule size. I can show you photographs of strata that are, even on the surface of the Earth, sorted by granule size, or exposed on the surface of the Earth, sorted by granule size. And see, that's a property, that's something that could only take place in rapidly moving water, whereas the granules are laid down, the strata are laid down horizontally, and the layers are created vertically as the material grows, extends horizontally by rapidly moving water, so that the heavier granules are deposited first, and the smaller granules being caught up in the stream of water because they are a lesser size and lesser weight mass, they are waterborne longer and deposited slower. Same thing would be happening. Imagine if you had a fish tank, okay, full of water, and you had in your hand a container full of pebbles, powdery dirt, and rocks, okay, and you shook this up real good, and just as you got through shaking it, you turned it over and dumped it real quick into that tank. What you find is the big rocks would settle real quick to the bottom. The pebbles would drop slower, and then the dusty dirt was going to settle real slow to the top. And that's precisely what we see in the geologic column. sorted by granular size.
We see a bunch of...
I invite you to investigate then. See, this is something that you're unaware of that you really you should investigate.
Well, I'm not going to find something that isn't there.
Really? What if I showed it to you right now?
Go ahead.
Okay. I'm going to Google Images. I'm clicking Strata. Okay. All right.
Strata are support are
now, geological. I'm pasting a link
in no
right here.
Order.
Click that link. It's a long URL, I realize, but click that link and you'll see. Strata sorted, clearly sorted by granule size with very, very fine boundaries between them, very highly defined boundaries, you see. And if strata were deposited over a vast periods of time, they would not have fine boundaries because uniformitarianists believe that these strata were laid down over a vast amount of time and deposition would change slowly from one material to another. See, there would be no fine boundaries between the strata at all. Should be gradiated, you know, very gradiated.
Dude, that was weird, man.
I see nine distinct layers.
Right. You should not, if uniformitarianism were true, there should be no distinct boundaries between the strata. Look how clear those boundaries are. They could only happen if they were created, deposited rapidly. You see, if they were deposited over slow, vast amounts of time, we would see gradiated deposition. In other words, it would be very gradual from one to another, you see. These would blur and blend up to each other. You see what I'm saying? But that's not the case. See? Do you see that the granule size is heavier at the bottom? Look at the strata in the middle. Let's see, like the third one up from the bottom, the one at the very bottom is lots of gravel. The one above it is sand, stone, and gravel mixed in. Then the same thing with the one above it. Now, do you see that third one up at the top? You see how it's got more gravel at the bottom and it's much more sandstone at the top? That's what I'm talking about, sorted by granule size. And this is common in the geologic column. If you go up three more, you see another one. This sorted heavily, greatly by granule size. Lots of gravel at the bottom of it. It has a clear boundary with the next strata now. And then,
exactly my point. Right. That's different periods of uplift and deposition.
Well, I mean,
When the layer is no longer underwater and is no longer being deposited.
Oh, so okay, then you're positing that each of these strata was laid down by water. Is that right?
I'm not a geologist, but that's what it looks like.
Okay,
besides lava flows, I don't think there is another way to put down layers.
Okay, so if they were all deposited by rapidly by rather by water. Then why has the Earth not been globally flooded if all the strata were laid down by water?
Well, if it was one entire flood, then it would just be one layer.
These are
individual portions. Some portions of the land are sinking into the ocean. Other parts are rising up.
No, but
let me ask you a question.
Hydrology.
You can see it happening today.
Right, we can see it in the lab. Hydrology experimentation.
We can see it on the planet Earth.
No, what we see is what I described to you, that the strata have clear boundaries and that they would be gradiated and blend into each other if they were deposited over vast periods of time.
Let me ask him a question real quick.
Okay, but let me just say this one more thing.
Okay, I'm sorry.
We can prove with hydrology in the laboratory that the stratification of the Earth took place rapidly moving water, because when we perform these experiments with various grades of material in the same tank added to the water as it's moving horizontally, we get exactly the kind of strata that we see in the Earth when we get a shovel and dig into it. Exactly the same. Now, I would like for you, if you believe that these strata were laid down over vast amounts of time, I really would like for you to tell me how the strata are not gradiated. That is, the one strata boundary blends slowly and seamlessly into the other. How could it be that, what you're saying, you have to believe that rapidly moving water quickly laid down this one strata, and then for some reason, no deposition at all for another 10,000 or 20,000 years, and then all of a sudden, more water lays down a strata. Right.
Yes,
and
that's exactly what happens.
No deposition.
Exactly.
So you believe that's why
we have all these layers, because there's periods of uplift, and then there's periods of subduction.
Okay, so wait, so you're saying that there are each one of these strata represents a considerable period in time, probably thousands of years, in which there was no deposition?
Right, because continents are, because that part of the continental shelf was lifted up out of the water.
Well, that would be the whole continent, because this is the characteristic of the entire continents, all the continents.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so you're saying then, if there was no deposition to account for these considerable periods of time, which there was no deposition, there were no geologic processes occurring in the Earth during that time. I mean, there was no wind, there was no rain, there were no storms, there was no local flooding, nothing. Nothing.
No, there were. That's why that causes erosion. So that when the deposition stops that piece of the continent has been uplifted out of the water, it begins eroding until it's subducted underwater again.
What?
I'm
not sure I follow that. You mean all the strata of the Earth individually went down and were created in the Earth, and then they came back up, and then they went back down again?
Well, water. They were created underwater, except
they were created in water. Right. Okay. Yeah. So, but I'm still trying to understand what is this mechanism by which all of the geologic processes of the Earth cease for, you know, I don't know, 36,000 years.
They never cease. I never said they cease.
Well, you said there was no deposition, and that's why we have clear boundaries.
Yeah, because it's out of the water. Instead, it's experiencing erosion.
Okay, so
But
we see local floods and rain constantly moves material from one place to another on the Earth constantly.
Yeah, that's where some of it goes.
Right, but it erodes from one place and deposits in another.
Yeah.
Okay, so there would be no deposition, though? Of course there would be deposition continuously going on and erosion continuously going on. If that were true, how could there be clearly defined boundaries again?
Because it's been out of the water for thousands of years.
Okay, JR, really.
Oh,
You don't see the absurdity of what you're saying. You really don't see it. You don't see the absurdity of thinking that each strata of the Earth was laid down relatively rapidly by moving water and sorted by size. And then, for some reason, there's this long period of time in which there is no deposition. And then another strata with a perfectly beautiful, clear cut. I'm like putting two pieces of bread, white, one wheat, right on top of each other. And then, again, another strata forms in water. And then... And now, if that's true, how do we get sedimentary strata from the deep inside the Earth all the way to all the strata going up to the top, the surface of the Earth, if they were formed in water, each one? And you're saying the Earth bounces up and down, then into the water, comes back up, and it subducts, and then it goes, it's uplifted,
it's
and then it's
called tectonic plate movement.
Okay, so with each strata, the Earth goes every single strata, the Earth gets subducted and then uplifted again.
Well, it's not the entire Earth at once, because that's what every some parts are rising up, some parts are sinking down.
Okay, but the strata were already laid down before any of this occurred. See, okay.
What do you mean?
But I mean they're laid down if there were strata laid in, even if it were uplifted after the strata was formed. How does it retain a clear boundary with the next strata above it, and then one above that, and
because
one above that?
Because once it's down under, once after a period of time subducts again, it's going to be encountering different environmental conditions, which will cause a different layer of sediment to form.
I see. So as every strata is formed, that strata, wherever it is on the Earth, whether it's at an altitude of 1,000 feet or it's at sea level, it gets subducted buried underwater again, and then the Earth comes back up again for every single one of these millions of strata. That happens constantly. That's so, TR, oh, wow, really? Okay, so if that's true, how come we don't see the Earth wobbling up and down constantly, and people going, oh, I got to move to another city, this one's going down? Why, how come? Because how many strata are on Earth? You know there's millions and millions of them, right?